honey here this morning, and the topic of the day is going to be expanding your apiary, how and why. Look at that honey dribbling into the jar. It's a beautiful thing, and it smells like a very floral honey today. It's light in colour, and around here the notes of the honey when it's light are often the floral bursts of the flowers. It's a wonderful thing, and look at all of those bees standing on their comb surface. That's the frame that the honey is harvesting from, and look at the bees. They haven't really even noticed that the honey's draining out from beneath their feet. I could sit here and watch honey flow out of a hive all day. I'm going to have a taste just because I can. Wow, it is. That's the wild quince honey, or goya, which is a local rainforest tree. And the floral notes are so pronounced that some people don't even like this honey because it just has such a pungent floral taste of flowers, but I love it. It's awesome. So expanding your apiary, how and why. Now, if you have a look here, we've got a number of hives, and bees are incredible. They tend to build up as time goes on. So as they build up and get busy in this hive, then they want to multiply. Now, multiply in a variety of ways. They can multiply by swarming, and that's their natural tendency. Or if you get ahead of the curve, you can do what's called a split and take some bees from this hive and start a new hive from the bees from this one, which you probably already know. So what that means as a beekeeper is there's this natural expansion of your apiary. And if you don't want the bees as they naturally expand, then somebody else probably will. So it goes without saying with beekeeping that there's this tendency of your apiary expanding. Now, let's just discuss today how and why, and we will be answering questions at the end of this the video. So if you've got questions, put them in the comments below and we'll get to answering those as we go. So why you would want to expand, beekeeping can be incredibly addictive. If you open your hive and stare in at the amazing world of bees, you quickly start this learning curve, and when you're learning, this fascination comes in, and with the fascination becomes this, I want to see more of what's going on in the hives. I want to look after more bees. So naturally what people tend to do is they start with one or two hives, then the next season they might have four hives, and so on. But there's a few things to consider when expanding your apiary. One is why you're doing it. Perhaps you are just fascinated and you want to see a lot more bees, and you want to look after a lot more bees, and you want the amazing effects of pollination in your area, and perhaps you just want to share honey around and share it with your neighbours and share it with your friends. Or perhaps you want to build up to the point where you're selling honey. And some people with the flow hive are paying off their hive in the first season because they're getting enough honey to do that. And if you're in a conventional hive model, there's lots of different beehives in the world, and you should try all different ones and find out what works for you. So in a conventional fashion, you're building up, and there's a point where you're going to have to pay off your equipment. So if you're going for conventional spinning, you might have purchased a conventional extractor. You've got a conventional extractor. You need to go through the process of pulling the frames out, putting them into that extractor. So there'll be a certain number of hives before the economics works out that you're actually making money from buying all of that equipment and running those hives. The flow hive's a little bit different because it's all the extraction gear's in the hive. So you can just sell honey from having one or two hives and build up that way. So we're getting a little bit of rain here, so we might just cover up the honey jar as it's coming. And I also noticed that one bee got interested, which sometimes happens, and it's jumped into the jar, so I'm going to pull that out. Again, if you've got questions, put them in the comments below. Look at that beautiful jar of honey. So sometimes the bees will get interested. If you see that, it's a good idea to cover up your jar of honey. I'm going to get this.
Cedar, we've got a question here from Sophie Smith, and she's asking, what does it mean when the honey is really sour?
Okay, there's a few reasons why honey could be sour. Sometimes it's the flowers. I was tasting a sweet and sour honey yesterday, and that's simply the flower source that the bees are going for. Other times it could be sour because there's some fermentation that's occurred. The water content's been too high. Sometimes the bees will even have the water content too high right inside. Inside the frame of the hive. Other times you've harvested a bit too early and the honey's not quite ripe. The moisture content's too high and it'll start the fermentation process on the shelf. And is that a sour flavour? It could be considered a little bit sour. Have a look at these bees around the corner here. So that's the frame we've just harvested from. And look at that, isn't that beautiful? The capping's still sitting there. The bees are just, the comb surface is like drum skins under the bee's feet, and they're going, hang on a second, the honey's drained out from beneath my feet here, I better start uncapping that cell. And then the whole process of waxing up the cells starts again. It's a wonderful thing. So to cover up the honey, you can use just a simple wrap like this. This is a honeybee wrap, so it's got wax on cloth, and you simply can wrap it over the top of the jar like this, and that'll keep the rain out and also any bees that might get interested in the honey. Okay, we'll leave that there to harvest while we continue answering questions. And today we're talking about how and why to build up tendency to expand. So it's natural that you start off with one or two hives and end up with four the next year. Now it's a good idea for that expansion to happen along with your knowledge as it grows. So the rule of thumb is double or triple your apiary size each year if you're planning on expanding, but perhaps go beyond that because your knowledge needs to grow with that expansion, and you don't want to have big learning curves on a massive scale. So it's normal just to say, oh, okay, I'm gonna split these two hives and next year I'll have four, then the next year I'll have eight, and so on. Some good questions coming in.
Chris Eggers has a question about his expanding hive. He says, hey guys, I'm in West, been warm this week, a lot of bees hanging around the front and sides, even after sunset. Brood box is full and heaps of bees in the super. Should I be adding another brood box?
Okay, so there's a few options there. Your bees are expanding. They're right around the entrance. Sometimes that you'll even see them on a hot evening covering the whole front of the hive all the way up to the roof, and you go, wow, what a lot of bees. So that's a really good sign of a healthy colony. The thing to do, there's a few options for you there. You can either add more boxes or you could take a split. Now you could still take a split this time of year. We're in our summer here, and so it's a bit of a choice there. If you want to add more boxes, you can either add another brood box, which is the ones where the queen is laying her eggs, or another super like we've done here with a double super on this hive. So there's two honey collection boxes, and either one's okay. Beekeepers will have their different opinions on why, so find out as much as you can and make your decision on whether to add another brood box or another super. But what I tend to do mostly is take a split, because it's always nice to expand. I run about 40 colonies at home, and the numbers get low each year when I tend to supply people with bees, and then the numbers get low, so I take more splits to replenish it, and I keep it around about 40 hives. So taking splits is my preferred option, and that's what I'd do if I was you. I would get in there, take a hive split, and then more colonies is better, in my opinion.
Cedar, Megan Bailey's asking, do you have to add another hive or another brood box? If they swarm, do you lose the lot, or you'll be left with a half of the hive?
So if they swarm, typically half the bees take off and they push the old queen out of the hive, and the hive raises a new queen. And while that works most of the time in terms of the bees raising their own queen, sometimes they don't. So you can get into issues where your hive ends up queenless, and then they'll slowly dwindle away unless you rectify the situation. So that's where your beekeeping comes in. One, to notice that that's going on, and also to fix the problem when you notice that they are queenless. But most of the time, if they do swarm, hopefully you can catch that swarm. Sometimes you do all of your spring swarm prevention, but they swarm anyway because the genetics are such that they really want to divide and swarm. And hopefully you can catch them, but if you don't, either way, you need to look after the parent colony and make sure that the numbers are strong enough to keep hive beetle at bay if you've got hive beetle in your area, and also just make sure that it's queen right, and queen right's the term for a hive that's got a laying queen.
We've got a couple questions streaming in from YouTube. This is a comment, actually. Amazing idea, says Craft Madman. You are a genius. I want this flow.
And thanks.
Chris Airy says, hi, Cedar. Do you look back on inventing the flow hive and wish that 3D printing was around at the time you for prototyping designs?
I certainly do wish 3D printing was more advanced when we were prototyping. One of our very first successful prototypes for the first jar of the honey came out in the world in this way. It was from a 3D printed piece of comb, but it was a piece of comb just this big, and it was over $2,000 for that amount of 3D printing. So it's nice that 3D printing's come down on price for inventors and prototyping. It's an amazing tool. It's still hard to get quality enough for the bees really to like it, so you end up doing a lot to those 3D prints in order for the bees to actually use them.
Kyle Register and Matthew Clayton are both asking about new products in 2021 from Flowhive.
Okay, fantastic. We're always innovating and always trying to improve, so if you've got suggestions, put them in the comments, let us know, write to us, and the idea is we keep improving as we go. So watch this space, and hopefully we will have some improvements that you'll like as time goes on.
Oh, and another one from Dean Clark on Facebook. Cedar, you're holding us all Flowhive owners in suspense. When's the big announcement happening? The suspense is killing us.
Okay, so there will be we're still trying to work that out. We'll come back to you. We do have some improvements coming, but it let's just put a lid on it a little bit. It'll be much the same harvesting honey from your beautiful hive. We've just got a few improvements coming.
Kari Soretti is asking, my second question is, I wonder if the bees still have an opportunity to form their own wax comb aside from the pre-built comb.
Absolutely. So in the bottom box here, or if you're using multiple brood boxes, it could be more than one box. Here you've got wood and wax frames, just as it's always been. We tend to do naturally drawn comb, which means we just supply a wooden surround so the bees draw their comb perfectly natural, the way they've always done it, whether they're in a tree hollow or wherever they are. So the bees just do their natural thing down below. And then our invention box sits on top, and it's only when the bees are happy and are built up to the point of where it's time for the bees to need more area, they move up and start storing honey in the flow frames.
Joshua Roots wants to know more about how you treat for mites going into colder weather with the flow hive. He also says many products state to not use with the honey supers, so do you remove the flow super and replace it with a Langstroth one?
We're really lucky that we don't have the Varroa mites here in Australia. And we're one of the only continents left, I believe, without the Varroa mite or the Varroa distractor. And it's a bit of effort, and there's various different management plans for managing mites, ranging from genetics to look after the problem right through to various different chemicals to help reduce those mites. And beekeepers will often use a mix of the two. I'm no expert in Varroa because we don't have it here. What I would suggest is asking the beekeepers in your country where their management practices. Ask the local. I got thebeekeeper.org, which is a online course designed to take you from square one right through to a deep scientific knowledge and competence in beekeeping. So have a look at that. We have experts from around the world chiming in, helping to teach you about things like Varroa. So basically, if you've got some good knowledge on Varroa, also help the people on this thread to get their questions answered. So Fred Dunn's also got some great information on Varroa, if you want to look up his YouTube channel.
Curious as to what Richard Land means when he says this, but maybe you can bring some light to it, Cedar. He's asking, I just wondered whether you've experienced the queen turning into a drone layer.
Okay. Have I experienced that? It's hard to tell. I'd say I have, not recently. But basically, if the queen runs out of sperm from, she only mates in the first week or two of her life, and that's enough genetic material to last a lifetime of laying, and she might live up to 6 years. But if that runs out, then she can only lay unfertilized eggs, and those unfertilized eggs will be males or drones. And drones don't collect nectar, they don't collect pollen, they don't do jobs in the hive. So the whole hive turns into this kind of, it's like a share house. When you've got a whole lot of males in a share house, the thing just kind of disintegrates into decay and you have to start again. But yeah, basically, if you have that issue where you've got a drone layer, you will need to replace the queen. More commonly, the issue is you don't have a queen at all, and the workers start laying eggs. If the hive has been queenless for weeks, then the workers may start laying eggs, and they lay unfertilized eggs, and they're drones as well. So that's most commonly the reason why you end up with a whole lot of drones and the worker brood diminishing to none. Either way, you'll need to rectify the situation by getting your hive queen right again and making sure you have a laying queen in your hive.
Brad Hergert says, hi, when doing a split, is having a queen cell enough or is a new queen needed?
So a queen cell is enough. So there's a whole lot of different ways you can go about taking a split. You can buy in a queen with a queen breeder. You can do what's called a walkaway split, where you get a frame that's got eggs on it, bee eggs down the cells. They look like tiny little grains of rice. You put them into your new box without a queen, and the bees that are there with those frames can raise a queen by feeding the young larvae royal jelly for its entire 11 days of the larvae stage. So another way, as you said, is if you notice a queen cell on a frame and that queen cell is capped, you've got a queen that's about to emerge sometime in the next 7 days or so. So you can put that frame into a new hive, and that's a great way to start. It'll give that colony a jump start for a new queen. Once she emerges, it could be a number of weeks before she's laying, because she's got to go through the mating ritual, and also if the weather's not good, she might not fly and do that. So if you put that frame into a new hive to take a split, it might be 3 weeks or so before you're noticing bee eggs down those cells, so you may need to be patient.
Yvette Henderson has noticed that you've oiled this hive rather than painting it and wants to know what's the best product to protect your hive for longevity.
So, if you're wanting to keep wood looking like this beautiful natural wood tones here, then I would recommend the Western Red Cedar wood, because it naturally resists the mildew, it naturally will resist rot, and you can keep it looking good like this outdoors. However, you'll need to give it some TLC every 6 to 12 months, rub it back, give it another oil, because wood is trying to turn back into the earth outdoors, and it will grey and decay eventually without a bit of TLC, a bit of rubbing back and reapplying oil, or a good outdoor house paint. So your options are basically oils like this, or outdoor house paints that are made to resist the harsh elements. And you can go either way. If you're choosing our Araucaria model or our Polonia model, then you'll need to paint it. You can see some nice examples of painted hives further up the row, and you can have a lot of fun painting your hives also. If you're choosing an oil to oil your hive, the decking products are built for outdoors, the ones you put on your deck to keep it really sealed in the outdoor environment will last the longest. However, they are tainted with often a tint, and that tint is actually designed to stop the graying. That tint helps stop the UV graying the timber. This doesn't have the tint in it, so this will eventually go grey after some years. So some things to consider there. I really like these natural tones of the wood without the tint, but it won't last as long as a good decking product.
Mario Marisi says, happy to say I've started my first 2 flow hives last weekend. I'm excited to start this amazing journey. Any quick tips to help a newbie out? Major do's and don'ts for a first timer.
Excellent, okay, great question. So the first thing I would say is if you're feeling a bit nervous, a bit uncomfortable about it, get some help. Even if it's from a friend who's only just started recently, it just helps to have somebody else there as you go about your first episode of installing your bees. It also depends a little bit on your method of installing your bees. You may go for buying a nuke, which is probably the easiest way to go, and that I would recommend is a great way to start. Buy a nucleus, which is a little hive that's got just 4 or 5 brood frames in it, complete with bees, complete with brood, complete with some honey stores, a laying queen. It's basically a little beehive. And all you need to do is get in your bee suit, get out your smoker, transfer those frames into your brood box, look after them, and they'll grow. So that's a good tip. People learn in all different ways, so some people will tend just to jump in and just learn as they go. Other people want to do a lot of study. If you want to do a lot of study and learning prior to getting your bees and installing them, then that's a great thing to do. You can have a look at the beekeeper.org, which is an online course we've put together with experts from all over the world, or you could go to a local bee club, or you could do a hands-on course learning about bees, and all of those things are wonderful things to do. We've also got a lot of content on our YouTube and Facebook where you can do a lot of learning as well. And of course, I'm here most weeks to answer your questions.
Caleb okay. Thompson wants to know, in the future, are you thinking about doing biodegradable flow frames instead of plastic, or is that not possible? Do you want to let him know why that might be a problem?
Okay, that is a great question, and of course, it really suits our values to have a product that is completely biodegradable. And we hope that one day we will, but it's this balance between we want a real long-lasting product. We want our frames to outlast all the woodware in your hive. And to do that, the bio products at the moment that we are testing, we still don't have confidence that we're going to get a really long-lasting product, because as you say, they're made to be able to biodegrade. There's also issues with temperature and shrinkage in some of the bioplastics we've tested. and sometimes your frames are exposed to high temperatures. So all of these things we are looking into, and hopefully one day we will be able to offer a completely biodegradable product.
Laura Patmore says, inspection question, full honey supers are heavy. Any tips for a small person? Can I lift the frames out separately and rest them on the ground?
Absolutely. So some people do that. If you are alone, you don't have help to lift your hive and you're not strong enough to lift the full honey super, especially if you've got the larger size box, the 10 frame Langstroth, or we call it a 7 frame flow hive because flow frames are wider. So as you say, you can simply smoke the bees and take a few of the frames out, or all of the frames out if you want to lessen the load. And your bees will be fine with that, depending on the genetics actually. A lot of bees are fine with that. You take the frames out and that'll make the box very light to lift off, and you can go about your inspections from there.
Do you want to let Mario and Laura know also what the best way is to lift a honey super, maybe using the window door?
Sure. So you take the roof off first by the wing screws on the side, and that'll just make it a little bit lighter. And you can use this area here as a handle. It's a really good, generous handle. Some beekeepers wonder what we're doing, how come we don't have a handle? It's because all you need to do is take this cover off and you've got a really nice handle there. The best way to lift a hive is always keeping the weight close to you. There's a handle on this end, and after you've freed the box up just by cracking it with your hive tool, you can then lean it back towards you and hold your core, and if you have something already at height to put it onto, then it's easier on the body because all you're doing is leaning back a bit, moving and resting again. Having said that, if you've got back issues and things like that, do get some help. Make sure you don't strain yourself, or as said, you can take the frames out one by one.
Nellie and Jack Sheridan say, morning Cedar, I've experienced 3 swarms in the last 3 days, 1 from Sunday and 2 yesterday, all from the same hive. On opening the hive, found 8 queen cells, got rid of 7 and kept 1. Could not find the new queen anywhere, possibly out mating. Replaced 3 full frames with empty ones to give more room. Any other suggestions? Thank you.
Wow, that's incredible. Well done for getting in there and working all of that out. And sometimes you get really swarmy genetics, and we've had that here at the office, and we've actually been doing some requeening swarm tendency, only because if they really have a high tendency to swarm, then it can just become a little bit of a management issue. And especially if you're in suburbia, you don't want bees hopping the fence too many times. Jars of honey always sweeten up the relationship, but it depends on your neighbours on that one. So generally beekeepers try and manage the swarming tendencies, and if you find, like you have, that the bees are just really building up and dividing and swarming multiple times, then it could be a good idea to buy in queens of known genetics, and then you'll find that problem will go away. Sometimes beekeepers will use a colony like that to create a whole lot of splits. They're breeding up really fast. They're breeding queens really fast. You can really expand your apiary quickly, and then they'll go back and change the queens for known genetics later if they don't want that swarming tendency to continue. Excellent. I'm impressed you're getting in there and finding out all the issues and finding all of those queens and so on.
Johnson Lanesse says, we got a winter now in Norway and it has been between minus 15 and minus 17 degrees Celsius, and it's so nice to see the bees flying. A question, how do you get the humidity down in the honey when you have a flow hive?
Okay, so the humidity in the honey is controlled by the bees. So there's probably a fair bit to this topic, but I'll just cover it broadly and then I'll go into the conventions in beekeeping. The humidity, basically, nectar starts off with 95% water content or so. The bees then bring that back into the hive and they need to reduce that down to usually around 18%, sometimes to 16%. Sometimes the bees are a bit lazy on it and they'll have it closer to 20%. Now if it's around that 20% above range, it could start to ferment even in the frames in the hive, which in a really humid climate, you can see that happening sometimes. Most of the time, if they've capped it, the bees have decided that it's going to keep for a long time and it'll also keep for a long time in your jar on the shelf. However, what commercial beekeepers tend to do is they'll do a lot of blending of honey. They'll blend honey that might have 22% moisture content with honey that's got 16% moisture content to get it to 18% moisture content, which is acceptable for sale. So on a commercial scale, they really want to make sure they're not having jars of honey that are hitting the supermarket shelf that are going to change in any way. So then they go through pasteurization, which means that it's really unlikely to go candied in the jar, destroying a lot of the health benefits of honey. And also blending to make sure you have that moisture content so fermentation won't occur. Now, as a flow hive honey producer, you're probably producing honey on more of a boutique level. And while you could go to blending honey, it's much nicer to just fill jars from specific frames and enjoy the different flavors that come in and even market that to your customers. That's a single frame honeys filling your jar, taste the difference, and you get different colors and different flavors for your customers to enjoy. Having said that, on occasion, you could get the moisture content too high in the jar and you still might need to go through a blending procedure. And if you are selling a lot of honey, then you should get a portable refractometer, which is a little device. You put a dab of honey on it and you can tell the moisture content. And if the moisture content is too high, then you can blend it with some other honey that you've perhaps already harvested where the moisture content is low. Or you could use that honey for making honey mead, or you could go through a procedure of reducing the moisture content, but that is a bigger scale. There is honey dehydrating machines and so on that you could either make or buy. But generally, on a boutique level, you wouldn't be going to that that space. Amazing to hear about your beekeeping in Norway.
Cedar Usman's tuning in from Pakistan and he says, how can we keep the ants away from a beehive? Is there any option available in the flow hive?
Hey Usman, good to hear from you. So there is. If you have a look at the leg bolts on the flow hive too, you can see there's room here to make an ant barrier. So one thing you can simply do is put a bit of grease on the leg bolts here. You might want to extend them out a little bit further and that'll create an ant barrier. Then what you need to do is make sure any foliage that is touching the hive is pulled away. The ants will quite quickly walk up the foliage and onto the hive if you've cut them off the hive. Now other people make little water moats by putting the feet in a bowl of water. You could also do that. I find if you provide a bit of a barrier and you brush them away a few times, the problem goes away. Now, you'll find ants will get behind the covers here, and that can be unsightly, but it's not actually a problem for the bees. The bees will keep the area inside the hive ant-free. Look at that. We've actually got some beautiful examples of the bees' honey in the frames. And if you look at this, it tells you a story, and the story that it's currently telling is the bees are a little bit hungry, and you can tell that by the way there's cap cells all the way down and suddenly some missing ones that are missing all the way. So the bees are uncapping the honey and eating it and consuming it for raising brood and keeping themselves alive. That's what honey's for, right? But lucky for us, they make more than they need often, and we can share in some too.
Henry Foucher is asking, how many seasons can the flow frames last?
So we're hoping they'll last a very long time, and if you've had any issues, do get in contact with us. We do want them to last a very long time. We have frames in my apiary that are well before launch in 2015, and they're still going today. So that bodes well for a very long lasting time. But of course, it's a new invention, and we don't know. But what I will say is, if you do have any issues, get in contact and we'll look after you.
Scooty Leg from YouTube is asking, can you start a hive with a queen and a few workers?
You need a bit of a critical mass in order to do all of the jobs in a hive of building comb. They have to excrete wax from their wax glands and do their amazing job of forming the honeycomb with their mandibles, and that then creates a space for the queen to lay. Once you've got larvae, there needs to be enough honey and pollen. So you'll need a critical mass, like one frame that's got some honey on it and a laying queen and enough bees to cover those frame surfaces would be a minimum in order to take a split. Usually beekeepers are splitting by taking at least three frames from a hive, complete with the bees on those frames as well. Some great questions. We've got time for a couple more. Bit of rain coming in, but that's one nice thing actually. You can harvest honey in the rain with a flow hive. It's something you wouldn't really be doing in a conventional fashion. I used to do a lot of harvesting and selling honey to the shops from conventional Langstroth hives. And when it would start to rain, the bees would get pretty upset about the whole process. So you wouldn't be harvesting honey in the rain, but you can harvest from a flow hive in the rain, no problem. Look at that, we've got a beautiful big jar of honey. We've got about 3 kilograms of honey from that frame, and it looks like a nice low moisture content. And we thought it would be, because looking in the side window, you've got a lot of capping all over the frame surface there. And the bees are just starting to notice that the honey's drained out from beneath their feet. And you can see them, some of them starting to chew away at that capping. And over the next few days, they will have taken off that capping and rebuilt those cells, and the process starts again. That is a beautiful jar of honey.
We got a sweet success story here from Michael Barnes. Says, I put a 10 frame ideal on 2 weeks ago after a harvest. They're almost done with the ideal and are smashing the flow again after the harvest.
Excellent. It's fantastic when you get this synergy between a good healthy colony, lots of bees in your hive, and a lot of nectar in the flowers. Sometimes you get the flowers so heavy with nectar, they're hanging to the ground, and the bees just go after that, and it's incredible to watch how fast they can replenish the honey you've harvested. And sometimes in a week, the frames you've harvested are full again, and away you go. And of course, you get the converse where you may not get honey that season. Beekeeping is an agricultural pursuit, and it needs the rains, it needs the flowers, it needs everything to line up in order to get a really good honey crop. So that's something to consider when you're making your decisions about expanding your apiary, is why you're doing it. And if you're doing it for commercial reasons, you need to factor in the honey seasons and make sure in a good year that you're putting away some funds to prop up a year that's not so good.
Cedar, can you explain a little more about just how hard the bees have to work to bring in that much honey in a week?
Bees are the most extraordinary little insects. These honeybees, there's nothing else on the planet quite like it. A hive like this could visit 50 million flowers in a day. And if you added up the bee flight, it would be a couple of times around the world. Think about that, tiny little bees each one flying kilometres to get the honey and back again. If you add up all of that bee flight, it's a couple of times around the world. It's just really is extraordinary. And the bees only last 4 to 6 weeks when they're foraging like that. A single bee may only produce a quarter of a teaspoon of honey in its foraging efforts in its lifetime, but together with 50,000 bees in a hive, they can produce an amazing amount of honey and also pollinate an amazing amount of flowers. Thank you very much for tuning in. We'll be back next week with another great topic, hopefully a little less rain. And if you've got some things you'd like us to cover, please put it in the comments below. And we will again try and answer your questions. The idea is we're trying to drop those barriers and help you become a beekeeper and help you look after the bees the best you can. Of course, if you want a flying start, have a look at thebeekeeper.org. We've got a lot of training material made to take you from square one right through to a deep scientific knowledge in beekeeping, and a lot of really practical videos to help you in beekeeping. We better take that jar of honey away before the rain gets into it. Look at that, isn't it a wonderful thing? I will just close the frame now. So to finish the harvesting process, all we need to do is insert the tool in the top slot there, and then turn it again, and what you'll find is all of the parts of the flow frame are now going back together. The bees haven't noticed that either, because it's all happening from beneath their feet. We can then take out this honey tube. Actually, I'll get the little cap ready. There's still more honey to flow out. You could leave it, but there's so much there that this jar might overflow. So we don't want to let that jar overflow. Its remaining bits go back into the hive for the bees to reuse. So we're going to take that tube right out, put the cap back in, and then one neat thing you can do with a jar of honey like this is rest the tube right on top of the jar, and the remaining honey will go back into the jar. Thank you very much for watching. Isn't that a beautiful jar of honey? Harvest it.